Welcome to week 14 of the Ask Our Vet series, live from the Earth Animal Studios. There we go. You guys can see me. That's great. All right. We're going to show up. We open today. You know, one of the things that I'm trying to do each week is I'm going to try to have the music that I do match the state for that our independent retailer comes from. So our spotlight this week is from Pennsylvania, which we'll talk about later. So I was looking for some bands from Pennsylvania, and there's actually some good bands from Pennsylvania. Rusted Roots, one of them. But I thought we'd go a little more old school, a little more obscure, and we open with the Hooters. So anyway, we're going to do this again. Now, this is the second time I'm doing this, so I should be pretty practiced, I hope. I don't think anybody saw anything, so we're just going to take it from the top, right? All right. Anyway, welcome everybody. I hope you had a good week. I hope you are looking forward to the weekend. The weather's nice here. We may get some thunderstorms through this weekend, which is, you know, obviously topical because that will be our talk today. We're going to be talking, we'll do a COVID update, and then we're going to be talking about thunderstorm and firework phobias and anxieties in our companion animals. Something this time of year is definitely prevalent. So I think it's a good topic for us to go over today. COVID update, right? So as we move into our different phases around the country, we're seeing a rise, which we expected to a degree. We're seeing a rise in COVID in people. We have no new animal things to talk about, which is great. What we are seeing, unfortunately, is a few hotspots emerge in the country. Florida, South Carolina, the Myrtle Beach area, obviously has been, in the news lately because of how many new cases are there. And, you know, I think that what we learn from this is that it is super important that we still, even though we're phasing back into whatever our new normal is for the next several months, I think it's really important that we continue to practice safe practices, which is hand washing, obviously, masks when you're anywhere in public. They're opening restaurants and things up in this area, and you have to, you know, they had them outside. Now you can go inside as of this week, but everybody's in masks that are not sitting directly at their table. And really, I see everybody, for the most part, 99% of people adhering to that. And I think that is definitely going to mitigate how many new cases we get here. I think, you know, we're in different areas of the country, we're seeing people not wearing masks and being in crowds and, you know, vacation spots, that sort of thing. And we see what the repercussions of that are. And I think it's really important for all of us. Again, we're a team, right? A big team. And we need to continue to work together, because even if you're not worried about yourself, you have to be worried about your loved ones, your parents, your children, your grandparents. So I think it's sometimes easy for, you know, some younger people to think, well, you know, worst case scenario, I can get this, but I can get through it. But it's not necessarily, you know, it's not necessarily you. It's the people that you, it's the people in your lives, the people that you touch, the people that you are going to be around that you can then give it to. So we have to remember that. And I think we all have to work as a team on this and continue to practice as much social distancing, you know, wearing our masks, hand washing, you know, sanitizing our hands, and just being, I think it's really important because we see the repercussions of what happens when we don't. So please, everyone continue to do it. And remember, if we do this and we continue to do this, the faster that we can get back to our normal, okay? Because if we don't get these huge rises in cases, then we can continue to have more and more things opened and, you know, and we can get back to life sooner. So I think we put in the work now, we all work together, the sooner we can get back to whatever that new normal is, and the faster we can get there, right? Okay, so, and we're gonna talk again today, we're gonna start talking about thunderstorms, fireworks, different phobias, anxieties, what we see, and then we're gonna talk about some tips that we, you know, that what I think, there's just several tips. Always there's a combination of different things that we can do, you know, both naturally and traditionally, medicine-wise, and also behavioral modification, because they always go hand in hand. You know, we don't always want to just, you know, I think there's a, I think a lot of times, you know, kind of prevailing thought that we can just throw something at something, and it, you know, we can throw, you know, the cure can come in a pill or a liquid or things like that. And it's always a combination whenever we're talking about any sort of anxieties or phobias or you know, behavior problems with our pets. You know, the behavior modification part of it is just as important as what we do. So we're going to talk about several tips for that. But first I want to talk about my Earth Animal of the Week. If you're new to the program, just a little bit about the Earth Animal of the Week. Once a week, I pick who I think is my Earth Animal of the Week, either a person or an animal that has touched me in some way, or I think is a really inspirational story. This week, I'm a little heavy-hearted with my Earth Animal of the Week. Several years ago, a cat, a little unkempt kitty, came to Ash Creek Animal Hospital, my veterinary practice, and she had bounced around in several homes because she was what we call an inappropriate urinator, right? She really, Sasha, her name is, wasn't a big fan of using the litter box. She pretty much used everywhere else other than the litter box, and they had tried several different things, and she had been adopted in several homes, and so we took her at Ash Creek, and she's been our hospital cat now for several years. She was 16. She was just a great cat. She had the most particular meow. You knew whenever you heard her that it was her. There was no way you could, and no other cat that I've ever heard had that particular meow. And she would, the first one to greet you when you came in. She had 50 beds all over the clinic that she would lay in. She was just, she was a great cat. She was 16 and we lost her this week. So, She was really, for us at Ash Creek and in our Ash Creek family, just a big part of our family. And I thought it would be remiss of me not to mention her, because we're all going to miss her so much. So anyway, thanks, Dosh. Thanks for being part of our lives, for sure. All right, let's start talking about thunderstorm fireworks. You know, I would say to you that this year is probably I've gotten more phone calls this year than any other year that I've been in practice about this topic. Okay, and really, we've had some thunderstorms roll through. We may have some this weekend, but it's been mostly about the fireworks. For some reason, the 4th of July fireworks this year have been going on for 2 months and really loud. Big loud fireworks almost on a nightly basis. And so I've been getting a lot of phone calls, because when our pets are inundated like that and they're not used to those noises, and especially when they're not far and few between, it can really, really throw them off and put them into an anxious state. So I think that this is really right, currently, especially up here where we are in Fairfield County right now, and in this area in particular, I think it's very topical to talk about right now. Let's see who's checking in here before we get into it. Hi, Marianne. Good to talk to you this morning. Hey, Holly. Thanks for checking in from Florida. That's great. Hey, Steph. Yeah, it was good to see you yesterday. And Martha, Sasha was a great cat. Thanks. Candace, you have the same mask. Yeah, we switched up masks. I thought this was a cool mask. That's mine. That's mine. We share it. The giraffe and I share it. Happy Friday, Candace. Thanks for checking out the show. So let's talk. Let's talk about these anxieties. I think whenever I talk to somebody about them, whenever we broach the subject, the first thing that I tell them is that you need to know your animal, all right? So you need to recognize that almost every animal that has these kind of anxieties has what they call a safe place, right? There's an area in the house that they like to go. And so it's important, and it could be in the bathtub, it could be in the, you know, in the basement under what that we had, I'll tell a little story. We adopted 15, 18 years ago, we adopted this little bulldog we named Emily. So Emmy was one of a kind. She they had found her in a lot in the Bronx, I think, and we took her in, and when we took her home, like the second day we had her home, we had a thunderstorm, a big thunderstorm outbreak, and we weren't home. And she was in the kitchen at the house. And when we came home, she had dug through most of the door to the basement. It was unbelievable how much damage she did, and it was just because she was panic stricken. And we didn't know this, obviously, we had just gotten her. And her safe place, Emmy's safe place, was under the workbench in the basement, all right? And so whenever it was that time of year, or we knew that we were gonna have thunderstorms, or it was fireworks time, we always gave her access to that area. And she actually, she was good if she was there. She was, you know, it was down there. She couldn't hear them as well. I guess, it was the sound wise would be dull down there under the, you know, under that bench all tucked away in the corner of the basement. But she was good as long as she had access to that safe place. But you have to know your, and they all kind of will seek oftentimes the same place, right? So it's the first thing. You want to know your animal. Okay. I think the other thing too that I talk to people about is it's also important that you stay calm, right? Because, hey, P-Pat, it's also important that you stay calm, because remember, they feed off of us. They feed off our emotions. So if you're nervous because they're nervous, you just get in this vicious cycle where both of you are going to continue to escalate, right? So it's important that you stay calm as well. Okay. As far as things you can do in the house, you know, competing noises, right? So, you know, whether you have Alexa in the house, or you have a stereo, or you have the television, it's always good to have some background noise, some background calming noise on. You know, I don't know if you want to play Metallica for them, but I think you want to have some nice calm music going, you know, at a decent volume, not too loud, but enough that it can kind of, you know, just kind of soothe the environment and, you know, can compete with any of the outside noises. All right. You know, you can also redirect them, right? So that's another thing you could do. You may not be playing outside with them, obviously, but you can play inside. You know, you can be playing catch, you're throwing, you know, and fetch, or and sometimes it's just sitting with them and petting them and being calm while you're listening to music. I think all those things can help, all right? It's important to know them. Some animals love to be on your lap and be held. Others don't want to be. They want to be away somewhere. So you don't want to force them if they don't want to, you don't want to force them to sit on you if they're trying to get away from you. And, you know, when these things first start to happen, you can kind of let them go and follow them and see where they want to go. And then you can recognize those are generally, and they will. It's very interesting, but they will oftentimes, each animal will have a different place that they feel safe. So, but it will be repeatable a lot, which is interesting. I think, you know, with thunderstorms, you know, you have to remember that as loud as we can hear these, you know, their hearing is so much more acute than ours. Because you can imagine a big boom that we can hear. It's just so much more amplified to them. And they know these thunderstorms are coming, you know, four times, they say, at least four times further away, because they can sense the barometric pressure drop, they can hear the thunder going off, you know, four times the distance, so they know they're coming. So you know, even if you don't know it's coming, you can recognize the signs, and hopefully kind of do start some steps to mitigate that, okay? One of the other behavioral modifications that you can do, okay, is what they call desensitization, right? Which is you can, in order to get them used to things like fireworks or things like thunderstorms, is you can actually play videos on your television, right? That have, I mean, YouTube has all these things, right? So you can play videos on the television while they're there, several times to get them used to hearing that noise. And if they're used to it, it's not such a surprise when it happens. So that, you know, I know that, I'm not sure if Geraldine is on here, but we had a conversation, Geraldine and I, there you are, I'm sorry, I missed it. Hi, Geraldine. You know, we had a conversation. Geraldine is a firm believer in desensitization. Geraldine's a wonderful dog trainer, among a lot of other things that she does, but she's a great trainer and she has a lot of good tips. And we just had this discussion a couple days ago about it just being important. And so with some animals that can work, because over time it's no different than when your animals are young, you know, making sure that you're handling their paws all the time, so they'll be better with nail trimmings, right? You know, going in their mouth so you can brush their teeth, you know, getting them used to, when you get, they thrive on just like schedules and routines. And when you make this stuff a part of their life, they're just that much more amenable to it when things arise, right? Let's see what we have. Catherine, we had, there's a lot of dogs, interestingly, that get into tubs that find that. All right, Rebecca, you have a question. We'll get back to, you know, we've got some, these were more of the behavioral modifications. Now we're going to talk about maybe, you know, some mitigation, some treatments for it. Okay. We'll see what we have question-wise here. Rebecca, my pup doesn't have a place. She does want all her humans together, but she just paces around, shakes, and pants heavily. Should I try to create a safe place for her? Well, great question, right, Rebecca? I think that depending on how she reacts. Now, if she's pacing around, the one thing is, does she feel better? She wants her together, but she doesn't feel better like being held or on your lap, I assume. And if that's the case, you know, again, that desensitization might be something that you can do with her obviously you start with volume lower on the television. You can raise it up a little bit when you're showing these fireworks videos and thunderstorm videos. But, and maybe with her, that desensitization might be something we want to look at. It's hard to create a safe place for them necessarily where you want them to go unless they kind of, if you know that there's certain of her little chew toys that she likes, or she likes a certain bed, you can try moving that around. But it's tough sometimes to force them to go, force them to go a place that they just don't want to go. Let's see, what else here? Oh, thanks, Vanessa. Yeah, she will. Thank you. She will be missed. All right, Jamie Giever. I have a customer that has 170-pound Mastiff and purchased our Zen potion. The dosage only goes up to 120 pounds. Should she start at that dosage and just slowly increase if needed? Yes. I think always with any sort of, whether it's a natural med or it's, you know, again, traditional medicine, you know, we start at the lower end of the range and increase as needed. I'm a firm believer in that with everything. So that's a good question. Jill. Hey, Jill, how are you? I hope everyone's good. I'm going to come back to that question when we talk about meds. So I will get back to that question. Okay. We're going to do it. Hey, Lucky Paws. Thanks for joining. That's great. Oh, Rebecca, you're welcome. Yeah, and try that. And again, we're going to get into some other stuff here in a minute, Rebecca, that may help as well. Okay. And Lucky Paws, thanks for tuning in. And yeah, we love you as well. So thanks. All right. So let's start talking, you know, what we can do otherwise. So we talked about, you know, kind of behavioral modification tips and what we can do in the house and what we can do as owners. And so I think now we talk about, and there's obviously, and one of the things on this show, you know, that open book, I'm a traditional veterinarian. I believe in integrative medicine. I've been lucky enough over several years to work with Dr. Goldstein, who has created some wonderful natural remedies for things like this that we're going to talk about. And you know, my whole feeling is, if you can do something naturally and it works, why wouldn't you, right? So I think that's always your first step and your first go-to. So we're going to talk about it. All right. obviously, you know, one of the first things that you know, naturally you can do is some of the natural herbal remedies, right? We have a few at Earth Animal. One of the ones that Dr. Bob has created that works well is this Calm Down, okay? And he recommends that when you're talking about fireworks and you're talking about, you know, an event, you know, that's coming up, that you would do it a few days before and a few days after. So you want to take that hyper anxiety state down, and, you know, so you take it down before, you get a little heightened, and then you smooth it out after. So it's always good to do it a few days before, through the event, and after. There's another Earth Animal product called Emotional Balance with highly anxious animals that you can use regularly for that anxiety. And then you can actually use them both together when you have really high times of anxiety in these guys. Hey, Saxenberg Agway, how are you? Thanks for joining. We're going to be talking about you in a little bit. All right. So thanks for coming on. So, you know, in that, you know, that remedy has, you know, chamomile, ginkgo, passion flower, valerian, and other things just to calm down. And the whole point to whenever we use any sort of natural med or traditional med or anything for this is, you know, the whole goal is to just bring the anxious state down to a norm. You know, we're not interested in, we don't want them sedated necessarily or, you know, overly sedated. We just want them to bring them as close to the norm as we can. And that's always the goal with this, right? The other thing that we talk about, that we also have a line in Earth Animal, and obviously there's other companies that make it, is the CBD products, okay? And, you know, those have obviously come into favor over the past, you know, year and a half, 2 years. There are a lot of people, there are a lot of animals taking this for various things, you know, arthritises and, you know, aches and pains, but also anxieties. I think anecdotally, we are seeing a lot of benefit from CBD in animals with anxieties. And, you know, there's more and more studies being done now, you know, across the country in different places about some other, you know, real cool applications to it for some disease processes, okay? So those are going to start to come out over the next couple of years. But I think, you know, right now we're talking about anxieties. I do see my patients that go out and get, again, they're not all created equal, so it's important that you know which product you're getting. They sell them all over. I think it's very important that you know that you're getting a good product. Always hemp-based. That's very, very important because, you know, again, we do not want any marijuana based. There are states where obviously their marijuana is legal. And so we do not want to give our pets marijuana based CBDs because the THC level in those it is too high and can harm them. Okay. We always want them to be hemp based. Our Zen line at Earth Animal has several that we have a transdermal product, that you can put. We have a transdermal product that you can put in the ear that absorbs, just absorbs through the skin, gets in the bloodstream and disseminates out to the body. It's a great product. There's also a tincture. Okay. And there's also tablets. All right. So it's, you know, it is again, and really they all work well. It's just a matter of knowing your pet and knowing what route that they might be easiest. Some of them don't like orals and, you know, and the transdermals work great. Some of them don't mind orals. Some of them eat the tabs as treats. Some of them will eat it in their food. Some of them it's easy to give the tincture to. So, you do. And yes, Holly, just going back to, I always recommend a hemp-based full spectrum, right? So that means that it has a very, very, very small amount of THC, it's not psychotropic, not enough to harm, but just that helps with the uptake on the receptors in the body of the beneficial CBDs. Okay, so that's a great point. Thanks for pointing that out. And you can use the CBD products as a, you can use them only on times of stress. If the animal's not anxious other times, I oftentimes, you know, when people use them for anxieties with groomings or boarding and thing, I do recommend similar to the Calm Down that you start a few days before and you then through the event and use it a few days after. Some animals that are anxious, or they may have like a time of year like this where you know there's fireworks going off every night, you know that there are thunderstorms around, they may, you know, seasonally may take it every day. So there's a lot of different options. But I think naturally, when you talk about it, the emotional balance, I think the calm down, and certainly the CBD line, the Zen line, are all great products that you can do that are natural and that can really help. Again, with the behavior modification, always important to do both, okay? I've never come across what they call panacea, a cure-all, where you can just, you know, give something and on its own, it's, you know, it just cures everything. I think you always have to couple therapies, right? An integrative approach, behavioral approach are always good. Let's see. Yes. Lucky Paws, good point that they calm down and emotional balance can be used together. I had a long conversation with Dr. Bob about this yesterday, and he did say that they can be. I always, any chance I get, I can sit and talk to Dr. Bob for hours because his knowledge base is unbelievable on this. And, you know, I'm trying to learn everything I can from him, which is a lot and it will take some time, but he is... His knowledge base is incredible. Marianne said, my neighbors get so nervous, and they told her to get a thunder shirt. So thunder shirts are another thing, you know, that as far as, you know, non-invasive things to do. I will tell you that I've seen it work really well with some animals and not work at all with others. Just like anything, right? Can it hurt to try? Absolutely not. Angel, you know, with Hendrix, Hendrix, you know, at first with the fireworks was just absolutely wouldn't go outside, would shake for hours, like you said. And so I know with Angel, we've taken a multiple kind of approach because, Hendrix has about as bad a fireworks phobia as it gets. And so I know that, you know, we've worked hard to kind of couple things, right? Let me see what you said. Yeah, I know. And that's, you know, if you remember like last year when we didn't have this problem, Angel, we had, you know, Hendrix on a few things and they worked well because he wasn't inundated like he is now. And so I know that you've had to implement more and more things this year because it's just been, this year has been really tough. I know the fireworks are an every night thing. Let's see what else you have to say. Yeah, I mean, it is scary that, you know, that anxiety when they have it so severely like that is it's really scary. And I know, you know, we just have to take a multifactorial approach and do everything we can for them. And I know you do. I mean, you're amazing with them. Okay, so Randy, I assume probably you're talking about the CBD for bath time. Any sort of anxious event, any of these natural products can be used for. So, and again, if you know bath time is coming up, it's probably good a couple days before to start it and kind of do it through bath time and a couple days after, so we can really just keep that kind of that anxiety meter low, right? And just keep that baseline where it needs to be. And I think, you know, the last thing is, and like I said, and, you know, from an integrative approach, if you do try like a year like this where it's, you know, where there is, you know, just so much, where they're inundated with these things, you know, with these loud noises right now, and that some of these animals are just, you know, breaking through a lot of meds, you should contact your veterinarian because they may, you know, there are other meds to talk about. There are anti-anxiety meds. I think you were talking about the Cilio. I think that was Jill. Yes, I haven't used much of that, Jill. So I don't have a lot of personal experience with it. I knew, you know, obviously, it is labeled as that anxiety med. I think I know some of my colleagues have used it. We can have a conversation. I can check with. I know a couple of my colleagues have used it, so I can check with them and see what their experience is with it, and get back to you on that. So I can give you a call offline on that. That's not a big deal. I think there are several anxiolytics and things that they may use for this. All right. So, really, I mean, we don't want them to be just beside themselves. It's not a state we want them in. So, you know, I do think it's important if it gets to the point where you're trying a lot of different things and trying these things and you're still having a hard time and they're having a hard time, you know, absolutely you want to reach out to your veterinarian because they can also help talk you through this, have some other ideas, talk about some different meds. So I think that's important. All right. Well, listen, I think that's the bulk of the, phobia talk. I think an anxiety talk, it's something that you have to try different things. You have to see what works for your animals. But it is a tough time of year, and especially this year. Let's see, Rebecca or Marianne. Georgia. Hi, Georgia. Is nervous if she is outside, but in the house, she barks when they go off. Is that nervousness? Yeah, I think too. I think obviously they bark because it's a noise that they don't like, you know, and it sets them off, similar to, you know, any other noise that's outside that your dogs may bark at. But I think, you know, it's just, remember, it's louder to them and it's more, you know, off-putting to them. So they really do. So it's likely a little bit of both. You know, it's protective and it's nervousness. All right, Rebecca, we've been doing the calm down, but only when we know an event like thunderstorms is coming. If we do a few days in a row, is there a particular time that we should be giving it? Also, what is the max amount of days in a row we should be giving it? Well, I think, there's not definitive maxes, but I think, you know, when we're talking about, if you're in a row where you're in a month where they're going off every day, it may be good to use the emotional balance. And then you can put into it on days that are bad, a calm down. I don't think necessarily there is a time that you can do it as well, but when we're talking about thunderstorms specifically, you know, thunderstorms generally come in the afternoons. Oftentimes, we sometimes get them in the morning, but I would think giving it in the morning or like late morning might be a good time to do it. But if you're managing a long time, like Dr. Bob had recommended, I think, you know, emotional balance is something to look into, and then you would add in the calm down for those really heavy, anxious times, right? For whatever the cause of, you know, thunderstorms or the fireworks. Okay. All right. I'll address, you know, as the questions are coming, I'll address them as they come. We're gonna do our spotlight now. All right. Our spotlight this week is Saxonburg Agway. Okay, in Saxonburg, Pennsylvania. And obviously, I hope you can get, that's a great picture, all right? I believe that's Annie. But anyway, we love Saxonburg Agway. Why? John and Ashley McDivitt both grew up in the Saxonburg, Pennsylvania area. John started working at Saxonburg Agway in 2000. Ashley began working there in 2011. That's when their future together began to blossom. They got married in 2017 and later that same year, purchased their favorite store. They've always taken pride in their small hometown of Saxonburg, keeping many of the unique touches that the store has maintained from its original time as a feed store in the late 1800s. Many of their products are sourced from independent family-owned and operated businesses, including various animal feeds, pet treats, and even peaches and nectarines sold throughout the summer that they drive to eastern Pennsylvania to purchase. They give back to the community whenever possible, donating to local sports teams, churches, outdoor organizations, and individual people and causes. This year, in response to the COVID-19 pandemic, they donated an entire pallet of dog food to anyone who needed it. It's unbelievable. We love that most days at their store you will find Annie, their Bernese Mountain Dog. Annie loves to see everyone who comes into the store, especially children and pups. By far, Annie's favorite snack is the no-hide, which I think we see right there, right? And it also happens to be their number one selling treat because it is a wonderful, wonderful pet treat. And you know, interesting, you can tell how great a business is by the shout outs that their clients and their customers give them. I just saw a few on the internet that I wanted to share. Aaron said, well-deserved shout out. I am so happy to be in a small community with such a great local business. Kelly said, John and Ashley and their staff are awesome, always helpful and giving to the community. Michelle said, one of my favorite stores, always a smile and great service. And Steve said, great people, great store, glad to have them as our neighbors. So I think those are the testimonials you want right there, and that tells you a lot about it. So please, you know, get out there, get to Saxonburg Attaway. You know, it's really, really important this time of year to shop local and shop these independent retailers, because, you know, it's been a struggle for a lot of small businesses during that COVID times, and we're just starting to get, everyone's just starting to, you know, crawl out of those times. So please, you know, go there and go often and shop local. It's really easy to go on the internet and buy things, but it's really important to purchase within your own community. All right. So I'm going to give you a password this week, right? So the first caller to call in with our password to Saxonburg Agway will get a $50 gift certificate, okay? And like I said, the last couple weeks, we've had some people call and get these certificates from out of town, even out of state. I think, please, if you can, if you're local and you can go there, please, let's try to keep this local. That's the whole point of this, right? So, all right. So the password is Spunky. All right, first person to call, Saxonburg, say Spunky, $50 gift certificate. All right. All right, great. Let's see what else. Annie's really cute, that's for sure. Becky, you're welcome. Yeah, I think, you know, sometimes these things escalate a little bit as some of our animals get older. And, you know, their anxieties, and I think it happens in people too. I think part of it too is a lot of these guys, you know, with the COVID, their world has changed. You know, I know, again, we always talk about how they thrive on a schedule, and, you know, a lot of their schedules have been upended. You know, I know a lot of them appreciate people being home, but, we're going to switch back, right? So a lot of people who have been home for months are going to start getting back, going out, going back to work, and that can even increase the anxiety more. So we will, so it is important that we do everything we can to mitigate that, right? Right. So you're welcome. Thanks. All right, Marianne. Dr. Chris, I'm going to email about seeing Georgia. Do you have Saturday hours? Actually, you know, Marianne, the answer is yes. We're going to go back to Saturdays. Because of COVID, we had some limited hours to start. We're building them back now. And so we're going to be back to full time this in July. Saturdays are going to come back in August. So in August, we will be back on Saturdays. And yes, I'm going to be doing a Saturday. So that's something we can fit you in. And that's great. I appreciate you making the drive, and I appreciate, you coming up. We've talked several times. I can't wait to meet you in Georgia. So, that sounds good. Heather, love these podcasts. I'm a vet tech and I've learned so much from, you're so welcome, Heather. And thank you. Thank you everybody for tuning in. I think, you know, I've been lucky that you guys, come to watch this. I have to be honest. This is one of my favorite things to do and one of the highlights of my week. Don't get me wrong, I love practicing, I love seeing the animals, but, you know, just kind of getting out there and doing this and preparing for this each week, you know, uses different muscles, different mind stuff, so I really enjoy it. So, heartfelt thanks to everybody who's been tuning in. I really appreciate it, and we're going to keep doing them. As long as you guys will keep watching them, I am enjoying them, all right? Let's see, so just a few things. Next week, we're going to be in observance. I'm going to be away next week, so I will, we won't have a show next week. The following week, we're going to be going to Thursdays, okay? I think we're going to be going to Thursdays for the summer. I think sometimes as the summer rolls on, Friday afternoons are tough for some people, so we're going to go to Thursdays at 4. So July 9th will be Thursday, you know, that Thursday at 4 o'clock. We're going to go back to Chew School, okay, and talk different chew toys and that sort of thing and chew safety. I think it's really important, and so we're going to do that, all right? All right. I think that's it, everybody. I won't talk to you guys for 2 weeks. I'm gonna miss it next week. It's been we've done 14 of these, and it seems like it comes so quickly every week. It's amazing how time flies. But Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. Hey, Jewel. Hi, Stephanie. Thanks to everybody for tuning in. I really appreciate it. Have a great weekend. Have a safe 4th. Remember, let's keep those masks going. Let's play by the rules. I want everyone to have a great time, but let's just continue to take all the precautions we can. All right. Here is another artist from Pennsylvania. I love this song, and it's pretty inspirational and uplifting. So enjoy and have a great weekend. Thank you, Angel, and we'll talk soon, right? Hopefully I can see you soon. Thank you, Randy. Yeah, you're welcome, and me too. All right. It's Matt Asayu, so everyone enjoy. Bye, everybody.